I want to introduce us to the topic that is at hand. And today we're going to be reading out of a very famous story that Jesus told as he walked along from village and town and city alike, preaching the good news of the gospel of none other than God himself. Jesus preached the message of repentance. Jesus preached the message of love. He healed the sick. He laid hands on the paralyzed. He healed the blind. His desire was to see sinners come to repentance. His desire was to see sick people healed. And how many of you know that the church is for sick people? Amen. This place is a place where we all come because we are sick. We all have sin. Somebody say amen. Church ain't for perfect people. You see, Satan wants us to believe that church is for people that got their stuff together. The devil wants you to believe that church is for folks that got no guilt, nothing to worry about, nothing uncovered. I mean, you know, nothing that they got to worry about. Because Satan doesn't want you to step into this place. Satan doesn't want you to be encouraged by brothers and sisters in Christ who have experienced the goodness and the faithfulness of God. Satan doesn't want your life to be fruitful. Satan doesn't want your life to be worth anything. He wants to keep us down. He wants to keep us oppressed, depressed. That's Satan's agenda. And then he wants to keep us busy in life, so busy that we don't even make time for God. But today, I pray that you are encouraged by God's word. See, I want to tell you the story about a farmer. A man who carried a leather pouch around his neck, which sat at his side, and he was a righty. So he reached into the pouch on his left side, and he would grab a handful of seed, and he would throw out the seed, and he would let the seed fall on whatever kind of soil the seed found. Wherever the seed found a place, there the seed laid. In this story, I want us to understand who the farmer is. So if you have your Bibles, turn to Luke chapter 8. Luke chapter 8. We're going to read about this farmer. Oh, he has the largest farm in the world. His land spans across the continental divide. His land, somebody say his land. Amen. Is a good land. The Bible says that the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. You want to say that with me? Everybody say, the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. Good. So this means that wherever God is choosing to throw his seed, he is expecting that earth, he is expecting that soil to be good. He is expecting. He has no reservations about where he's going to throw out his seed. Luke chapter 8, beginning in verse 1. After this, Jesus traveled about from one town and village to another, proclaiming the good news of the kingdom of God. Somebody say amen. Amen. The 12 were with him. And also some women who had been cured of evil spirits and diseases. Has anybody here ever been cured of an evil spirit? Let everyone say amen. Because if you got sin in your mind, sin in your heart, there is an evil spirit there that continues to lurk. There is an evil spirit there that is just waiting and looking for an opportunity for us to open that back door right there so he can wreak some havoc in our lives. So there were some women who had been cured, though, of these diseases and evil spirits. Mary, called Magdalene, from whom seven demons had come out. Not one, not two, not three, not four, not five, not even six, but seven. Someone say seven. Seven's a godly number, amen? But in this case, it was a devilish one. She was good and filled up with evil spirits. There was a perfect number of demons that possessed her soul. Some of us, before we knew Jesus, was like this woman carrying on, walking about the streets and the byways and the highways. Matter of fact, we were so evil, we were scared of ourselves. Joanna, the wife of Cusa. Somebody say Joanna. Can I teach you a little bit something about Joanna? Okay, Joanna was the wife of Cusa, and Cusa was the manager of King Herod's household. He ran things. He was the medo-medo for King Herod, the tetrarch, Herod Antipas. So Cusa was a man of influence. He was the one who called some shots. He was like Joseph in the Old Testament, second in command of all of Egypt. But in this case, he was like second in command of all of Israel under King Herod. Are you following me so far? Cusa had a wife. Her name was Joanna. Joanna was one of the most faithful followers of Jesus Christ. Can you imagine what dinner time was like at their home? Cusa come walking in the door talking about, oh, JoJo, girl, let me tell you what happened with King Herod. You should have seen what he did. Oh, my Lord, God help me. I've seen more things in one day than I'd ever want to see in a lifetime. And she said, shoot, that ain't nothing. Let me tell you about my day. I was walking with Jesus. We were there with the disciples. There was a lame man who was laying on the side of the temple steps. They walked up. And Jesus said, get up and walk. The man picked up his mat who hadn't walked in 38 years. Talk about stories. I got stories too, she said. She said, now hush up, hush up, hush up. Go ahead and eat them pork chops. Go ahead and eat the corn. Go ahead and eat the mashed potatoes. Let me tell you some more stories about a man named Jesus, a man that I love. Don't worry, cousin, you ain't got to get jealous. He can't do for me what you can, brother. Cousin was like, okay, as long as he ain't messing up what I got going now, huh? We cool. Her name was Joanna. Thinking of having a daughter, you might want to name her Joanna. Juana. Oh, yeah, back to the word. Susanna was another woman, and many others. Verse 3. These women were helping to support them out of their own means. So these were women of substance. These were women who, made, you know, weekly trips to Rodeo Drive. You know, they looked fashionable, but that wasn't the only thing that they cared about. Even though they looked good, they smelled good, you know, even though, you know, things were good in their world. They were followers of Jesus, and they put their money where their mouth was, and they would support Jesus' ministry. And Jesus said, get ready, y'all. We're about to go on, ship off to the next village, the next town. And Joanna and Susanna would come together and say, how much is it going to cost, Jesus? And Jesus says, how much money is it going to cost? I said, okay, here we go. Here you go, Jesus, go and do your thing. Sow this seed for me. Someone say amen. Amen. Have you ever heard of the concept of sowing seed through your financial giving, through tithes, through offerings, through blessing somebody's life, through a deed, through time, through energy? Wherever you sow in someone's life, you will reap a harvest. They were familiar to sowing seeds in the life and ministry of Jesus. Thank God for these ladies. Somebody say amen. Amen. Give God a hand clap for these ladies. The ladies that were in charge of the checkbook at home. The ladies that want to make sure that their tithes are paid first and they don't wait to the end of the month to pay what God. Okay, never mind. Stepping on some toes. All right. That's for another day. Amen. Verse 4, while a large crowd was gathering and people were coming to Jesus from town to town, he told this parable. A farmer went out to sow his seed. As he was scattering the seed, some fell along the path. Somebody say, some fell. Somebody say, Pepto. Not Pepto-Bismol. Someone say Pepto. Pepto means that it fell. The farmer scattered. He threw the seed and the seed fell. As he was scattering the seed, some fell along the path. It was trampled on and the birds of the air ate it up. Some fell on rock, and when it came up, the plants withered because they had no moisture. Other seed fell among the thorns, which grew up with it and choked the plants. Still other seed fell on good soil. It came up and yielded a crop 100 times more than was sown. So we got 4 different kinds or types of soil here, of earth. We've established, according to Psalm 24, verse 1, that the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. So according to Scripture, each and every one of these types of soil all belong to God. Each one of these 4 types of soil were all supposed to bring forth fruit. And the farmer sowed the seed indiscriminately. He didn't look and choose and say, oh, she looks good, let me sow seed there. Oh, he looks good, he's got money, let me sow seed there. Oh, they look like they've got their stuff together. That looks like a good family, good Christian family over at Albertsons. Let me sow seed there. No, the farmer does not have any prejudice. The farmer reaches into his leather bag and he throws out. And who's the farmer? God. Jesus is telling the parable. He's talking about Father God. So we got the seed that fell on the path. There was seed that was thrown and it fell along the path. And the seed that fell along the path says that it was trampled on by foot, rolled over by wheels, crushed the seeds, and the birds of the air came and ate those seeds and gobbled them all up. There was a second kind of soil that the seed fell upon, and that was the rocky soil. The rocky soil was the kind that the seed fell into the crevices between the rocks. But there was not enough moist soil underneath the rocks to allow the roots to establish themselves, to grow deeply, and then to grow up nice and tall, and then to produce a crop or fruit for God. Then there was the third kind of soil, the third type of soil, which is the kind that actually found good moist soil. And the seed fell, and it went into the soil, and it sprung up. Only problem was, it was growing up with a bunch of thorns and thistles. A whole bunch of weeds grew up with it and said, what's up, homie Lope? And choked that seed out. Choked out that plant. Now don't look to your neighbor. I know there's been some folks in life that you've wanted to choke out too. That's not what we're talking about today. You and I cannot decide who gets to keep the seed and who don't. Well, I hate their guts. There's no way that I want them to be forgiven of their sins. No way. Choke them out. especially my mother-in-law, choke her out. I'm just kidding. And there's the fourth kind, the fourth type of soil. The Bible says that this fourth soil was good soil. It was moist. It had been turned over. It was softened by God and by life. And this good soil received that seed that was thrown upon it. And the seed grew roots. And the seed grew up into a shoot. And the little green shoot turned into a tree. And the tree produced fruit. Verse 8, part C. When he said this, he called out, "He who has ears to hear, let him hear." His disciples asked him what this parable meant. He said, "The knowledge of the secrets of the kingdom of God has been given to you, but to others I speak in parables, so that though seeing, they may not see, though hearing, they may not understand." Jesus was into reverse psychology. Jesus would like for me to say today that though the gospel is preached today on this corner in this pulpit, there are people here that will still turn their hearts hard and make their lives calloused so that the seed that is being sent forth today would not find a home in your heart today. Could it be that life's circumstances and situations could possibly prevent you from being the kind of soil that produces good fruit for God? What Jesus would say is, you know what? There's a whole lot of folk here today that just don't have what it takes. That sounds like some of the many good coaches that I've had that says, you know, guys, there's a lot of you out there, but not all of you are going to make the team. Not all of you are going to have what it takes to be good enough. That's what a coach would say. And it would drive us players to work harder than we ever worked before. To keep growing, to keep challenging ourselves. Well, in this case, you don't have to work for it. You don't got to earn it. It's only free and it's given by God. It's a free gift of grace. It's called salvation. Thank God we don't have to work for it. Thank God we don't have to earn it. Yet still, Jesus is talking to a big crowd, a multitude of people that heard about what he was doing, that were delivered by his ministry, and were inviting others to come and hear what Jesus was preaching about. Verse 11, this is the meaning of the parable. The seed is the word of God. Those along the path are the ones who hear, and then the devil comes and takes away the word from their hearts so that they may not believe and be saved. Those on the rock are the ones who will receive the word with joy when they hear it, but they have no root. I'd like to say those are maybe some of us that have gone through life excited about what we heard. We were even moved to the point of tears or emotions and made an emotional decision. And we had become like a flash in a pan. We were here today and gone tomorrow and didn't allow that wonderful seed that had taken root in our hearts to continue to thrive. Somebody say amen. Amen. But a decision to follow Jesus, a decision to receive the word of God, is a decision that transcends our emotional state. It's a decision that goes beyond what we feel about God. It's also one that is considered with our mind. It's one that is completely considered with our whole being, with our mind, and with our heart, with our soul. Somebody say amen. Amen. And with all of our might. Jesus said, consider the cost before you begin to build the house, lest you come up short and not be able to finish the house. But don't let that stop you from making a decision for God today. Somebody say amen. Amen. Don't let that stop us from choosing him. It says in verse 13, part B, they believe for a while, but in the time of testing, they fall away. Pastor liked to call these choker Christians. That when crunch time is on the line, they choke. You don't want them coming to bat in the ninth inning with two outs and the game on the line. You want somebody who's got ice cold blood running through their veins. Somebody that ain't bothered. Somebody that don't get all worked up. Somebody that remains composed. If we can apply that to our faith, God is looking for Christians. God is looking for men and women, young and old, that are willing to hold on to that seed, to protect that seed. And when the trials of life come, when the testing of life come, we stand tall, unwavering, immovable, like the cedars of Lebanon, whose roots beneath the surface soil grab hold on to one another. When the storms of life come, when the winds of life come, those trees don't move. Because what the eye can't see is that the roots beneath are holding one another together. Could it be that God gave us the church so that we might encourage one another in the faith? Could it be that God gave us one another? Could it be that God made us brothers? Could it be that God put people in your life, in my life, that we might go through this life and that we wouldn't be affected by the storms of life? So that when the trials did come, we wouldn't run from them, but we faced them head on and stand out upon the mast? Could it be? The seed that fell among thorns stands for those who hear, but as they go on their way, they're choked by life's worries and riches. They're lured away. And pleasures, the lusts and the desires of the heart. The Bible says the heart is evil above all things. We covet things. We want what he has. We want what she has. We want what they have. We want to drive what they drive. We want to live what they live. We get lost in the rat race of life. I hope we don't got any rats in here. Don't get caught up in the rat race. But the seed on good soil stands for those with a noble and good heart who hear the word, retain it, and by persevering produce a crop. By hearing, by receiving, and retaining, and persevering, produce a crop. Might there be any good soil in here? Might there be a heart that has been pounded on by life? Might there be a heart that has been turned over and over and over again, broken and hurt? That needs a little bit of love. That needs a little bit of Jesus. Might there be someone here today who says, Pastor, I want to be like Mary Magdalene. I want to be good soil. I want to be like Joanna. I want to be like Susanna. I want to be like the disciples. I want my heart to be just as ready to receive the seed that God has thrown upon my life. Good soil will produce a good fruit. Good soil will produce a good crop. Good seed will produce good fruit, the Bible says. God is a good God, and He sees the godly potential in all of us because we are a part of His earth and we belong to Him. But it's life that hits us when we were young and we weren't ready for it. It's life that hit us when we were a teenager and we were pruned before we were meant to be pruned. It was life that came along and caused us to hurt. It was life that came along and abused us. It was life that came along and caused us to experience loss before we even knew what loss was supposed to feel like. And we turned our anger, we turned our frustrations, our confusion, our doubt, and everything else negative in the world that Satan has created, and we turned it towards God. But God wants to redeem it all back. And God says to the person who is the seed that is falling on the hardened path, that don't worry, your heart may have been hard, but guess what? It doesn't have to stay hard anymore. Right. Let your heart be kneaded through like good dough. Maybe your heart was like the seed that fell on the rocky soil. And for a little while, it felt good to serve God. It felt good to go to church. It felt God to praise and to worship. Oh, man, maybe that was you. Maybe that was me. Well, guess what? God said, if that's you today, you can take a couple steps over and let your heart become good soil. Maybe you're the thorny soil. Maybe you had good intentions. Maybe you have a good heart. Maybe you're the most generous person in the world. Maybe you take the shirt off of your back and give it to your neighbor. Maybe you would kill in somebody's honor. Well, guess what? The weeds and the thorns came up and robbed that good old plant of doing some good for God. Satan got a hold of that individual. Oh, I know some folks that are the best people you would ever meet in the world, but they're doing 25 to life. You go to the prisons, whether in Mexicali or Ensenada or in Wayside or LA County Jail, and you'll see some of the most beautiful people that you ever met in your life there behind bars. Why? Because Satan is a liar. Because Satan don't have not one good plan for your life or mine. But I tell you what, Jeremiah 29:11 says, for I know the plans that I have for you, plans to prosper you and not to harm you, plans to give you a hope and a future. Give God a hand clap today. You see, God doesn't look at whether you're rich or poor. God don't look at you whether you're good looking or ugly. God doesn't matter whether you're tall or short, skinny or fat. He don't care. He scatters seed among the earth because He knows that all the earth was meant to be good. God, He does see our color. He does see our race. He does see how much money we got. He does see what gender we are. He does see the sexuality that we possess and that we have, or that we may even struggle with. He sees it all, but it doesn't matter to Him. He throws seed upon His earth, which falls upon each and every one of us. And His prayer is that it would stick to each and every one of us. His prayer is that seed would go deep into our hearts. That's His prayer. According to 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 9, He says, and the Lord is not slack. His desire for all the world is that all should come to repentance, that all would not perish. That's God's desire, is that each and every one of us would have the same opportunity as the next to worship God freely, to know the things of God that I know, that you know, and you want them to know too. That's God's desire. The next thing that I saw was that this seed that the sower, the farmer, was throwing was like seed that was falling from heaven. Oh. It was like seed that was falling from heaven. You didn't get that over here. Let me go over here to the east side. Let me see if the east siders can get it. this seed was falling from heaven like manna fell from heaven. Like manna fell from heaven to the Israelites to feed them when they were stranded in the wilderness with no food, no water. They were in the desert. God did a miracle. Can I hear an amen, somebody? Amen. When God does a miracle, that means he saved their life. That means salvation comes from heaven. Somebody say amen. That means the farmer reaches into his grab bag and he throws out a whole bunch of salvation over there, over the people. God reaches into his bag. He throws a whole bunch of manna out there to the people. He says, come on, let me see you make some bread with this. Come on. Come on. This is bread from heaven. Come on. Go ahead. Take it. Take it and eat it. God from down from heaven. He's throwing it down there. God sent his son from heaven. His name is Jesus. He said, go ahead, Jesus, go ahead. I'm going to throw seeds of Jesus everywhere. Seeds of heaven. Seeds of Jesus. The Bible says that it was the word. If the seed, according to verse 11, chapter 8, says, if the seed was the word, somebody say, if the seed is the word, and the word is Jesus, and Jesus is salvation, then the seed is Jesus. And Jesus gives salvation. That's right. A equals B, B equals C. Therefore, A equals C. It's all geometry. It's all algebra. According to Psalm 78, verse 24, it says that he rained down manna for the people to eat. He gave them the grain of heaven. Some of us are walking around starving, staggering in life, desperate, dying on the vine. Uh-oh, did I just hit strike a chord? Dying on the vine. How could you die if you're on the vine? It's when we ourselves choke out the blessings that God has in store for us. We are dying, yet God is producing fruit. God is producing bread. God is producing blessing. God is sending down salvation. God is throwing off the life vest out there to us in the middle of the lake. But we're not grabbing hold of it. Oh, don't worry. I'm waiting for God to save me. Helicopter comes by. Grab a hold of the rope. Don't worry, God's going to save me. Sure enough, a guy comes by on a boat. Hey, man, jump in. Oh, man, we're doomed. Don't worry, God's going to save me. The water may be rising, but I'm here, I'm good. God's going to save me. Then we die. We stand before the throne. What happened, God? You were supposed to save me. He's like, man, I sent you a helicopter. I sent you a boat, and you didn't take none of them. What more do you want? You must hate your life. So smart, we can't even see what's right in front of us. Some of us are too smart for our own good, huh? God is just throwing seed from heaven. What if I stood up here today and started throwing out, let a huge bag of $100 bills fly around everywhere here? Would you just stay seated right there, all cool, calm, and collected? Like, oh, cool. Hey, those are green bills. You know, I wonder what those are. I wonder what denomination they are. You would not care. You could say 100 and they could have Benjamin Franklin's mug up on that sucker. Or it could be George Washington's $1 bills and y'all would be fighting each other over here, like, oh, girl, give me that dollar. You know, like candy falling from a piñata. Shoot, I'm a competitor. Are you guys competitors? Yeah. You guys like to compete? I like to compete too. That's why every birthday party, I was right there, man. I was like ready to go. I had a big old bag ready to get all the piñatas, you know. As soon as that piñata came crashing down, man, I grabbed my t-shirt, threw the bag down, and stole it from all the little kids. Shoot. That's what God's doing. He's throwing down candy from the heavenly piñata. He's throwing out $100 bills from his pouch. If you want it, he says, go ahead and grab it. It's all yours. It's got your name on it. Set aside for you. In order for that seed to grow up, it must first go down. Salvation comes by hearing. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
God is so good. So here we are today. may have come in with a hardened heart. Maybe somebody brought us here today. Maybe church wasn't even on the agenda in your smartphone last night. Maybe somebody came and swooped you up forcefully. Praise God. Maybe your mom woke you up out of bed, threw water on you, said, "Get up, boy, you're going to church." God will take it either way, because he knew there was about to be some seeds thrown out today. God knew you were coming. God knew what streets you would come down. God knew what excuses you had in mind. God knew that we didn't think we deserved salvation. God knew that we just want to keep shooting ourselves in the foot, because we've messed everything up already. We don't deserve mercy. We don't deserve forgiveness. We don't deserve anything good. My daddy told me so. That's what my mom said. You're just like your father. You're no good. Just like your mom said. It's just a lie. That wasn't from heaven. That was straight from the pit of hell. Straight from Satan's mouth himself. You ain't nothing. Better to hate than to love. Start with yourself first. Hate yourself. But God sent manna in the form of a man from heaven to go to this cross, this wooden stick behind me, this tree of life. Doesn't Psalm 1 say that we should be as trees planted beside the streams of living water? That in our proper season, we shall also produce fruit and our leaves will never wither. Jesus hung on a tree of life to give you life, 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 to give me life, to give the whole world life. You may have a hardened heart today, maybe a rocky heart with a rocky start. Could it be your thorny soil full of worry, caught up, weak in faith, and easily discouraged by life's trials? There's still hope for you today. You can still tenderize your heart today. Make your heart willing, humble, and stay as hungry as ever for the things of God. Stay planted next to the streams of living water. Jesus is our living water, and he is the bread of heaven. When you eat or drink of him, you shall never thirst or grow hungry. That's his promise.